These are the Snapchat spectacles. And I'm standing here at AWE at the Snapchat booth upstairs, where they've taken over pretty much the entire promenade to show off the capabilities of their augmented reality glasses. Now, here at AWE yesterday on the stage, they announced that coming very soon in 2026, you're going to have a new consumer version of these glasses. Right now, this is a reference design. You can only really get it as a developer, as you're building out developer experiences for using these glasses, as well as using the AR elements in the app. However, as the consumer device approaches and is going to be available and put on sale, all of those experiences that they are developing will then go to those glasses. Now, to give you a bit of comparison, these glasses are rather large, as you saw on my face. They are pretty massive. Now, keep that in mind as we go through this, because these are a developer preview. These are designed as a reference design for how it's going to work, but the tech hasn't quite finished being shrunken down to normal consumer size. To give you a bit of a space and feature comparison, these are the Xreal 1 Pros that I have talked about before. These glasses have the lenses up in the top here, and then they have a prism in front of your eyes in which you're able to see a full screen image, and is designed for you to be able to do full, rich media, where you have immersive, essentially a full, VR environment, virtual reality environment. Now, they can do pass-through, but primarily most people end up using this for rich content, immersive content, where you are viewing something that generally blocks out the world around you. You can also use these where you can see through it, but primarily I use them so that I can have my desktop, my screen up in space in front of me, and that's an absolutely fantastic use case. These, on the other hand, are designed to be for pass-through, for augmented reality. So you overlay a digital world on top of the world in front of you. Now, just to give you an idea of the size difference here, obviously the spectacles are much, much bigger. And the reason for that is, like I said, these are just a design preview or developer preview, a design reference, so that folks can learn how this is going to work when it does come to market, even though they haven't completely finished the consumer design. The other major difference here is that these are a complete all-in-one system. Now, with the Xreal glasses, they are powerless, right? They have no battery. They have a very little bit of compute inside. They have a very powerful chip, but that chip only has the express job of handling the degrees of freedom in space in which you can use the glasses and anchoring your content into its space in your space. These, on the other hand, have a full operating system inside, full computer, full battery, full communications, so they're able to communicate with your phone and other embedded apps that are either on the glasses or on your phone via Bluetooth or, I believe, Wi-Fi, although I can look up the specs afterwards when I'm not in the middle of a conference. As you'll see with these, there are cameras up front, one on each side, and then you've got a little status light here in the middle. Now, these are currently sleeping, so it is blinking there. And then on the flip side of these, and I'm not sure how well it's going to show. Oh, actually, you can see it quite well. So the part that has the less clear, where it's a little bit more tinted, those are the screens, and those show up and have content on them, and you are looking through them at the world around you. So when I have them on, it's like a regular pair of sunglasses. However, as you look around the world, there are different elements that are superimposed over your world. Now, I did a very cool demo with Niantic. They have an application that is developed on their system. I believe it's called Peridot, where they have these cute little creatures that run around the virtual world, and you can pick them up and you can play with them. And that is all enabled through a system like this, because this has sensors to be able to track where your hands are in space in front of you, whether it's in front or down below, so that you can interact with virtual objects in the world in front of you. I also was able to try them over here behind me, where they have an AI demo station, which is a little bit similar to what I experienced at Google I.O. with the Google prototype glasses, where you can use an AI, which in this case, I believe this demo was also using Gemini, where it can look through the glasses that are on these, and instead of having to go through your phone, for example, this is using its onboard connectivity and processing to be able to process that information and use an LLM to answer those questions for you. So, for example, if you walk up to a coffee machine and you say, how do I empty the grounds in my coffee machine? It will look at the coffee machine, identify what it is, and try to give you the answer. I don't think we're entirely there yet, but that's not on Snap. The spectacles are, the design platform that other developers are building on top of, and it is incredibly powerful to be able to do all of that. I did have some glitches both on the application side where, for example, I was looking at some records next to a record player and I asked what the record was. It was able to correctly identify it, but only after I looked down directly at the record as opposed to looking straight ahead and glancing at it in my hands down below. It wasn't able to see that. I don't know if that's a limitation of the cameras or the developer, but we'll get more into that later on. Then, rather hilariously, I asked it how long the record is, meaning how long in length all of the songs on the record are, and it opened up the measuring app and it started measuring how long the dimensions are of the record, which is not what I meant at all. So the whole AI thing, we're getting there, but still trying to tweak how it understands what we want in the real world. All that being said, wearing these really helps me to envision a future where, now look, I'm not going to be wearing these out and about everywhere I go. As you can see here, they're massive. And in some of the promo materials, they do show folks just walking around, meeting up with friends, and those other friends happen to be wearing these, and it's all a YouTube utopian wonderland where everyone is wearing Snap spectacles. But given that, again, this is a developer preview, this is not the actual physical product, that's not going to be the case. And as this always ends up being, it's not going to be this large forever. And as I've said in many of my other videos, this is the worst it's ever going to be. Okay, they're putting a lot of money into this. Meta's putting a lot of money into this. Apple's put a lot of money into this. Xreal over on the regular glasses side has put a lot of money into their systems. And they're all developing towards a future where, as Ralph from Xreal said on stage just a little while ago, they're working to make the hardware smaller and the screens bigger. Or in this case, the hardware smaller and the interface with the digital overlay world is going to be more all-encompassing and inclusive. Now again, all that being said, it is incredibly impressive, all of the technology that they have managed to cram into these glasses, including everything from battery, charging capabilities, there's a USB-C port on the back here, communications, the screens, there are speakers that are downward firing over on the sides here. Let me see if I can show that to you. Downward firing speakers on the bottom there. You've got the buttons on the top. Now, yes, they're thick, but again, this is the worst it's ever going to get. So overall, I'm very excited for the future of where this is going as an independent platform of being able to walk around and interact with the world around you, and looking forward to the day in which it gets smaller and smaller, and even folks like me who don't wear glasses on the regular basis have a comfortable way to interact with a virtual layer on top of our regular daily lives. Now, this is important as we move forward. Why does this matter? Well, as we continue developing AI, and there's a ton of AI content that is developed and is released into the world, and developed is probably the wrong word for it, because it's really more slop. So many people are going to be making content with AI where it just auto-generates whatever because they're trying to promote it, or they're trying to share things just to be able to get traffic and make some money off of the analytics and off of the traffic on those platforms. We are going to be putting more weight into in-person experiences. Why? Because, well, on the walls around me, those are real walls. You can't have somebody putting AI slop that I don't want to see the terrible generated AI crap that they want to show me. I want to learn about where I am. Say, for example, if I'm at a museum or a historical location, I want to go to the museum and I want to learn and I want to see those things and I want to do it in person, because then it is accurate. I can see it with my own eyes and it's not something that is faked or generated or leading me in a different direction. The problem with that is the problem that we face with all of those locations today is where if you go and you are walking around, you're limited to how they are displaying the information. A lot of times this can be static, can be boring, can be outdated. And now with a virtual layer on top, with a pair of glasses like these, you're going to be able to walk into this environment, have little tooltips pop up around you so that you can see, even if it's the same information, it's still easier to interact with in the world around you as you walk around and to see what's coming, etc. Now you can add on to that as well, for the museum example, where if you're wearing these glasses, A, you can have a guided audio tour where it's walking you around and it overlays an arrow onto the floor to show you where to go. And then when you get to the exhibit or the item that you want to look at, you can look off to the side and it will show you another, whether it's animated or filmed or archive, you know, video that was taken back in the day, etc. You're going to be able to have that in space right there. And so it adds and complements the whole experience and will be curated so that it is correct and accurate as opposed to just the, you know, AI generated slot. Again, keep in mind, these are massive, the battery life doesn't last forever. But like I've been saying, this is the worst it's ever going to be. And going forward, we're going to see a lot more experiences where you're going to be able to use things like these in order to improve them. One last point on that is the Louvre, you know, small museum, France, big pointy glass dome, made famous by being the Louvre, but also in the Robert Langdon novels and movies of the Da Vinci Code. They have been using the Nintendo 3DS for the last 13 or 15 years to guide folks through a tour at the Louvre. They had to stop and shut down that program in the last couple of months because they ran out of repair parts for the Nintendo 3DS. Not because the technology was dead, not because they didn't want to do it that way anymore, or they were moving on to a different platform, but because the technology was no longer able to be used because they couldn't repair the pieces that they have. I propose to the Louvre, get in touch with Snapchat, get in touch with Niantic, get everybody a pair of spectacles, and do the same experience and a better experience of what you were doing on the 3DS, guiding people through the world on something like this, where it is an overlaid environment that is going to be a vastly superior experience. And I'm very excited for the next generation of in-person experiences being enhanced by a second digital layer, a la Ready Player One, etc. Go and watch those movies if you haven't seen them before. So now that has been my quick review of the Snapchat spectacles here at the AWE conference in Long Beach, California. I hope you enjoyed. Please drop your questions and comments down below. I do try and respond to pretty much all of them if I see them. Sometimes YouTube is a little weird in how it shows off the replies of the comments, so if I miss it, I do apologize. But as always, thanks for watching.